Welcome to this month's tutorial. It's going to be a mixed media one and it features lots of ferns. Ferns are unfolding at the moment in the garden and they look absolutely beautiful. I love ferns so much. I thought I would do a mixed media tutorial because I absolutely love it. It lets you just be free and play and you don't have to worry too much about what you're doing. And the great thing is we move the stuff around before we stick it down, so you're not committing to anything. And if you can get into that zone of playing, all the more better. So it's a really good idea to collect images, collect things like receipts, tickets, postcards, anything that you'd throw in the bin that you look at and you think, oh, actually, that might come in handy for my artwork, and get yourself a box. I've got a giant box now. And keep all these bits of paper in that. Also, if somebody buys you a birthday present and you really like the gift wrapping, keep the gift wrapping, pop it into your box. You can also buy ready-made papers and they come in these books in different sizes. You can get them all over. You can get them online in the range, at the works, maybe Hobbycraft, places like that. And they come in all different designs. Some are really fancy and some are quite plain. So just collect them and put them in your box. Now I'm going to show you what I'm going to be using. A map out of an old book, some brown wrapping paper. These are revision cards, you can get a pack of them. This is jelly print paper, so jelly printing is amazing. We'll do that another time, and they make really nice backgrounds. These are some stickers that my friend sent to me. They're really good because they're quite see-through. Some little stamps. This is paper out of the books that I've shown you. Now you can make your own words by typing or ink stamping. All of these things are gonna go today. That's there was added sticky tape, Mod Podge. I love Mod Podge because it's a glue and a varnish. And this is Distress Ink. It's really nice. You can make things look old with it. And I've got a bunch of watercolour pencils in all different colours and all different places I've got them from as well. So let's get making, should we? I'm using a piece of card. So I've just cut this up. It was a printing error. So any piece of card will do. It's A5. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to start putting the paper together and seeing what goes with what looks good. Because sometimes you'll use all one type of colour and another time you'll be drawn to a different kind of colour. So this part is just about playing and getting used to what you want to use today. At this point, we don't stick anything down. And this is really important because if you start sticking things down straight away, you will make a mistake. Not, you can't really make mistakes in art, but you will make, what I mean is you'll make a mistake where you'll stick something down and then after a while you'll be like, oh, I don't actually like that there. So it's a really good idea not to stick anything down. Now you can see I'm just marking lines by using the edge of the card. And I'm going to cut them. I'm going to rip this part. I think ripped paper is really nice for mixed media. The lines, when you put the glue on, fit better. And I'm just seeing which paper I want to go with my ripped jelly plate print. Now, on that jelly plate print, it's not a fern leaf. I can't remember what leaf that is. Maybe a beech. But I have done fern leaves on the jelly plate and they do look really lovely. This is some watercolour paper that I had painted on a long time ago. It's Bockingford. I really like Bockingford watercolour paper. It's very thick, this one. It's really thick, so it's more like thick card. You can see it's the watercolour texture on the back. So when I stick that down, I'll need to doubly stick that because otherwise it might peel off. So I'm just faffing around now, as I call it, to see what goes with what. Which way up should it be? Does it look nice? I'm not kind of feeling that yellow. I could add the revision card and take the some of the yellow out. I think I'll just get rid of the yellow. So, yeah, I wasn't feeling that. This green's much nicer. That goes much nicer. I think that'll be perfect, actually. So I'm just going to score the edge with my nail down the card, and that's an easy way for you to get a line on it to follow for you to cut out. Another note about scissors cutting out. I have two pairs of scissors, one for paper only, which are my red handle ones, and ones for cutting the double-sided sticky tape. Because what you'll find is, whatever scissors you cut the double-sided sticky tape with, they end up getting really sticky and tacky, and then if you try and cut paper with them, it's really difficult. Sometimes I do make an error and pick up the wrong scissors, and then as soon as I've done it, I'm like, oh my gosh, why have I done that? So that's a really good top tip. Have two pairs of scissors, or more, but two is a good amount. So you see, I'm layering up now on this piece, and I'm wondering, what should I use? Just going through, and this is what I want you to do. Just explore what you'd like to use. Now, just because I've used ferns in this one, doesn't mean you have to use ferns. You could use whatever you wanted. It could be flowers, butterflies, foxes, I don't know, pigs, anything. So I'm just showing you the basis of layering up and figuring out where things should go. It is all about getting used to having a balance of things on your painting, your card, whatever you're making on. It is having, training your eye really to see where things should go, how much you should put on a certain area of your work. And when you've done it for a while, you'll automatically be able to see if something's not quite right. If you're struggling with this, a really good tip is to get a mirror and put the mirror, so if you've got your canvas or your whatever you're working on, face away from it, so you've got your back to it. And then get the mirror and look over your shoulder in the mirror at your piece of work. And it really is strange how quickly you can see, when you look at it in the reflection, which bits are off balance. I think sometimes when you're making a piece of work, you're so involved in it that you can't actually see what it is that feels a little bit wrong about it, or it's not quite gelling. But if you use the mirror technique, it's a really good tip. You can see it straight away. It's the weirdest thing. So get yourself a handheld mirror. I teach all my students that. It's a really good thing to do. So I'm going to cut this fern out, as you can see. And I'm just trying to cut out extra little bits of it to make it a little bit better. I'm not going to cut out all the individual leaves. I'll be there all day. But if you did want to cut out all individual leaves, it'd be easier if you had a craft knife and a cutting board. That'd work much better than a pair of scissors. But I'm not bothered about that, because you'll see later on that I actually colour in the edges with some green, so it doesn't matter. So I'm just positioning this. Now, you can still see I've not stuck anything down yet, because if I'd have stuck it down, I wouldn't be able to move it. So don't stick anything down until you're absolutely sure where your pieces are going. So I think I like this fern in that position. It looks good. And I like the ripped effect of the autumn fern words. So you see that harsh edge of the paper, the Bockingford paper? It's a little bit too harsh. So I'm going to add some of this brown parcel paper to cover up that edge. And because it's ripped, it just takes away that harsh edge of it being so straight. So I'm going to stick that down on top, I think, when it's time to stick. Still not time to stick. I'm still moving things around, seeing what can go where. I'm actually quite happy with this, how it's turning out now. So this is quite good. Get these bits of paper off, and I'm going to see if there's anything else that I could add. Not really liking the whole thing, but I could add some words. So you see how I ripped it again, and I'm going to get rid of the harsh line of the bottom by just adding some script. that's another tip for you. Collect old books that are knackered. Just keep a few, especially ones that have got like yellowy kind of pages. They always look really nice when you're doing anything with mixed media. But just start collecting and gathering things, because the more you can collect and gather, the more you'll have to play around with. Now, this is what I'm going to do my ink stamping on. I'm going to put a quote on this. And you can get quotes off the internet. You can make your own quotes up, whatever you want to do. And I'm just seeing how big my card needs to be to go on here. And as you can see, I've still not stuck anything down. I'm still figuring it all out. So if there's anything you take away from this video, it is don't stick anything down. So I know how big that's going to be now. Now, normally I would take a picture and then you would remember where your pieces go. So that's a top tip. But because I was recording on my phone, I couldn't actually take a picture. And it's fine. There's not too many elements in here to remember, but it is always a good thing. And also, if you're going to go off and do something else, it's a good idea to take a picture. You never know what's going to happen. The wind could blow, the dog could jump up, a child could come in and move things, and then you've lost where your pieces are going to be. So it is always good to take a picture. So I'm going to take everything off now. Now, if anything's square like this, I use the double-sided sticky tape. Double-sided sticky tape comes in different widths. This is a really skinny one because I use it for doing things like letters and words. But you can get thicker ones as well. These are about £1 up to about £4, depending on where you get them from. And they last for ages. They're really, really good. So I'm going to use the double-sided sticky tape to stick all this part down. At the end, you won't see me covering it all with Mod Podge because this is just for the tutorial. But if I was going to make something to sell, I would actually paint the whole thing in Mod Podge to make sure it was fully firm, stuck down, sealed and varnished. So I wouldn't just stick stuff and then sell it as it was, because eventually what happens is the sticky tape will lose its stickiness. If something gets warm, maybe it's above a radiator or something, things will start peeling off. So that's what you need to do. If you want to make something, you're going to sell it, you need to make sure it's fully stuck down properly everywhere. So I'm going to stick that down. It's going to form part of my background. And then I'm just going to glue that corner because the corner was lifting a little bit. I've got an old-fashioned glue stick, like what they used to use at school, but you can use anything for you to put your glue on. I did use a paintbrush, but it was a bit of a pain in the bum because it kept getting all stuck together. So I'm now going to do two things on this. Because this is the Bockingford watercolour and it's really thick, I'm going to put the sticky tape on, but I'm also going to cover all the middle with glue, because otherwise it'll peel off the card eventually because it's so thick. So that's just another little thing to do. So I'm doing it double insurance to make sure it sticks down. Lining up is really important, especially if you've got double-sided sticky tape on. If you've only put glue on, it's quite easy to shift things about. But with a double-sided sticky tape, once it's down, it's down. So make sure you line up your pieces. And you can see it's come over the edge a little bit. So I'm just going to snip a little bit off to make it fit. And also on the right-hand side, it's coming a little bit. It's fine, I'll just add some paint or something later on. So because this is thinner paper and it's got that lovely rip edge on it, I'm going to put Mod Podge all over it. You could use PVA glue, but what I found is with PVA is it ends up wrinkling your paper quite a lot, especially if it's you need a lot on, you know, when you put it on thick. Mod Podge is more expensive than PVA, but I feel that it's worth investing in that extra money to get a good finish. There's nothing worse than using things that are cheaper and you end up with not a good finish because it just makes you frustrated with your work. And that's not a great thing to do. And of course, you know, in the beginning, we all start somewhere. I started off with PVA. That's how I know it, that it wrinkles everything. And I couldn't afford to get any Mod Podge. But when I did, I realised that actually it is worth it. And it does last a long while. The tub only looks small, but you don't actually need that much on either. So it is worth investing in things when you can. So I really like that how this is going now. I think it's really good. Making sure it's all stuck down. And now I've realised, oh, I made an error. Because these were meant to go underneath. So you see, because I've put the Mod Podge on, I can easily pull it up a bit. If that was double-sided sticky tape, it would be a disaster. So now I'm going to stick these on. And that's the other thing. If you've got a photograph, you can see what should be stuck down where. But of course, I didn't have that because I was filming on my phone. And it's totally fine. So I'm going to put some quickly. I'm working quickly now to get it under there. Get some Mod Podge on there. Also, that's another top tip. Gosh, I'm full of them today, aren't I? Is have a piece of card. You see on the right-hand side, I've got that piece of card that my Mod Podge is on. And you can glue on that. So then it's not going all over your table. Just going to stick this down now. Put extra glue on there. I'm going to make sure all the edges down nice and firm. So that's sealing it there at the edge, which is great. So if you are going to do this yourself, get all your supplies together first. It makes it so much easier. I'm really lucky now that I've got a painting table, a separate one from my packing table. And I can leave everything out. Back in the beginning, when I first started, I worked on the kitchen table, which was also the home education table, the dining table. It was everything. And it was so frustrating having to put everything away every night. Really frustrating. So if you can, get yourself a little table. It doesn't have to be massive. Get yourself a little table somewhere, anywhere, if you can fit it in somewhere, that is just your own, just for making your art on. Because it's so much easier than having to put everything away at the end of the day. Bureaus are really good for that, actually, because you can shut them up at the end of the day. But I know that not everybody's got room for extra furniture. But I've been there. I even worked on a board on my knee over the couch. Like, I had like an armchair. It was actually not the couch. It was an armchair. And I had a board that went on the arms of the armchair and I used to work on that. But you was trapped behind it. You couldn't get up to do anything. Yeah, that's before we actually had a table. It's quite amusing. I did think one day I would have a room of my own to create in. I did think that. And I used to collect Kath Kidston magazines and look at different, you know, different places and stuff like that. I think, oh, one day I want it to be like that. But kind of at the same time, I didn't think that it was going to happen because my children was young and they were all little. Now they're all grown up and in their late 20s. So it's really nice that I can have this whole room to myself. So I'm going to get some watercolour pencils now. And I'm just going to go around the edges. So this is the thing that you do to make it look like whatever stuck on is going to pop out of your page. And I always match up the colours to whatever I'm making. So if this was an orange piece, I'd use orange, reds, yellows, etc. Because this is a nature one, I'm using greens and browns. And you'll notice that I'm not doing it everywhere. I'm just doing it on key points that are stuck out, so like a corner or an edge where it's got like a different shape. And I'm going to add some water to this. Now, a note about adding water to your paper. So different papers will react differently to the water. Old book pages, it might seep through and bleed quite a lot. And fresher paper, like printer paper and things like that, it won't do it so much on. So it's all an experiment, and don't worry, it's all fine. And while we're talking about paper, let's talk about hot press and cold press and what that means. So hot press goes through like a roller to really squash it and make it flat. It's a really flat, smooth surface. Cold press doesn't go through the roller and it has a textured surface on it. And when you're looking at paper like watercolour paper and it's got different numbers on, so it'll say 350 GSM, that the higher the number, the thicker the paper. So 350 is like card. So you'll just learn this. And I always prefer to buy paper in person so you can actually feel it with your fingers. So I'm going to get my watercolour paints out now. I've talked about these before. I highly recommend Winsor & Newton professional watercolour pans. Again, they are a little bit dearer, so if you can't afford them right now, that's totally fine. Just start off with what you can afford. De La Rowney and Winsor & Newton watercolours are really good. When I tried the professional ones after lots of years of using the ordinary ones, I could not believe the difference. The amount of pigment is massive. Now, before you use your watercolour, you should spray the watercolour pans with some water. I'd already used these earlier, so they were still wet, so I didn't bother. There was a couple that had dried out a little bit, I think the dark brown maybe, but the rest of them were still wet, so I didn't do that. But if you do that, it just brings the pigment out. So I'm going all along the edge here to make it just look like it's lifting a little bit off the page. So the idea with this is to make it look a little bit older and also to make it look like it's standing out. So I'm just going to do that over all the different edges. I'm really sorry that you can't see what I'm actually doing right now. I did not realise that it was off camera. That's really frustrating. But basically, I'm using this lovely umber colour and the bottom of the page where I added the script, I'm painting over that to make it look more old-fashioned. So you see, I'm doing it at the top now and it just makes the paper just look that little bit more old-fashioned. I really didn't know that my piece that I'm working on was off camera. What a nightmare. And I can't really go back and do it now, but you'll get the gist and you'll see it at the end what it all looks like. So this is just trial and error and getting used to how things are. I'm going to use this distress ink. This is fantastic. It comes in all different colors. I've only got the brown. And you can just rub it on the edges and it makes everything look old, which I think is really cool. I really like that look. You might not like that look, and that's totally fine. Now, if you don't have distress ink, you could use paint to do this. You could use a tea bag, or you could use coffee grounds. They're really good at making things look old as well. So don't worry if you don't have the distress ink. And it's by Tim Holtz. He does all sorts of stuff. He does stampers, sprays, enamel paints, all sorts of different inks. You'll see a lot of YouTube people using his stuff, and it is really good. It's from America, I think, so over here we only get a certain amount of things. You think you can get it from Hobbycraft? I think I got mine online, actually. So I'm getting quite happy with this now. I'm liking the way it looks. I think it's quite good. I've noticed that the edge needs sticking down, so I'm going to stick some more glue on this edge. Squeeze it together to get that glue out and make it stick down properly. You don't want things to keep lifting. So also what you can do is, now I don't know if this is what you're meant to do, but this is what I do sometimes. I actually use the Distress ink by just rubbing my paintbrush on the ink pad, and it just gives a little bit of a darker, more old finish. So, and I've not wet my paintbrush, I'm just using it dry on the Distress ink pad. So just add some little extra bits, so they are worth getting. So I think I'm quite happy with that now, how that looks. I'm just going to stick down the little leaves. They keep coming up. And yeah, I think when you're making, you just need to keep contemplating, what should I do next? What should I do? So I really like these watercolour pencils, the metallic. I'm going to go around the edge of the fern to make it pop a little bit. I didn't want it to look distressed and old like the rest of it, but I did want it to pop out from the back of the page. And also blend in some of that white from that, where I didn't cut it out. So I hope you'll try this and have some fun and see what you create. I'd love to see them. If you want to send me any pictures over socials or email or whatever, I'd love to see what you make with these. So I'm just sticking down the edges of the fern leaves because they keep peeling up. When you're doing stuff like this with fern leaves, did you see how I used my finger in the direction that the leaf was going with the glue? And because if you do it another way, it just lifts it back up again. So I think these were too white. They were too sticking out of the whole design. So I'm going to add some little leaf bits on here. And I don't want it to really detract from the rest of it. So if you look at the rest of it, it's a little bit blurred and it's not got very sharp edges. So I think I'm going to add some water to these edges of the leaves that I've drawn on. Again, I'm using my metallic watercolour pencil. I'm just going to wet these now and smudge them a little bit. So it's really important to take a second to look at your work to see what it needs. And I feel like this needs some black on it, some darker edges. So I'm just going to try and find my black pencil. There it is. I did have these pencils upside down at one point so you could see the colour to make it easy to pull out. But the trouble is it breaks the point of the lead, which was a little bit annoying. So I'm going to add some little black areas to make it pop even more. This is a really good tip, even if you're drawing with a pencil and you're going to draw something, say like you're drawing a still life, if you just go over it darker with the pencil in certain areas where it sticks out or where there's a curve or something, it will make your work pop off the page. So if you draw something and you just draw it all at the same pressure and in the same shade and tone, it just looks flat. But if you add little accents of darker, so darker pencil, or in this case I'm using a black watercolour pencil, if you add these accents of the darker, it just makes things pop. And you can see I'm being very minimal with it, really minimal where I'm going to put it. Just checking now, like as I'm drawing, I'm thinking about, okay, I don't want to go too over the top with the black and right, ruin the whole thing that I've done, because that's really easily done. Now looking, I've added too much black to that corner, so I'm just going to use a brush and soften it out to make it blend in with the rest of it. I'm really liking this now. I'm really liking the way that it's working out and that it's looking. I think it's really nice. It's looking good. So now it's time for stamping letters. If you don't have any ink stampers, you could do this freehand with a pen. You could type things on your computer and print them out, so you don't have to do it like I'm doing with the ink stampers. But there's just something really lovely about doing analog things. It's like, I don't know, it just calls to my soul. It's just so nice. And it takes ages, it really does, but it doesn't bother me at all. I love doing it. Now with this set of ink stampers, the U and the N is the wrong way around, so I always have to check. It's really annoying. It was stuck the wrong way around, and the, you know, it takes me ages to find a letter sometimes, but I don't mind. They were in alphabetical order at some point, and really I should take the time and the effort to put them back in alphabetical order, because it had stopped me faffing around trying to find things, wouldn't it? But it's one of them things that you never get round to. So I'm going to speed this bit up now, because it does take quite a while, and it's just me stamping. I'm just checking how big things are and how big a word I can fit on next. And you'll see my dilemma when I've done the whole sentence. I had to turn the sound off because Kiki D and Elton John speeded up, sounded hideous, like funny little chipmunks. Also, I've chopped off quite a bit of this, because even speeded up as fast as it'll go, it took really ages. So just use your imagination that I'm just sitting here stamping. So I've done all my stamping now, and I'm going to chop up the letters, the words even, into strips so they can fit onto the page. And this is the part where you've got to be quite careful. So I'm actually stamping on pieces of card, the same pieces of card that I'm working on to make the image. These are just offcuts of when I get printing done. I often get flat sheets. So when I cut out my artwork, that I end up with these strips, which is really handy. So they're really good for stamping on, drawing on, things like that. So as you can see, this was quite a big quote, and I didn't quite realise how many words there was going to be in it. So I think, as you'll see in a minute, I don't think it's going to fit on. Well, it fits on, it fits onto the card, but the trouble is it covers up so much. And that's not really what I wanted. So if you've made a really nice image, you don't really want to be covering it all up, do you? I don't think I can use that. Definitely not. Even if I cut it down to make it smaller, it still wouldn't work. So let's have a look. If we cut that so it's smaller, will that work? Will that be better? No, it's still covering up loads of the image. So I don't think this is going to work. So I'm going to have to do a different quote, I think, to make it look better. So I'm going to pick a much smaller quote this time because I know that that will actually fit on. And I've kept this in this video. I could have just cut that out and not even shown you that I'd made that mistake, but I've kept it in to show you that we all actually make mistakes when we are creating, and it's fine and it doesn't matter. And I'll keep that other quote to one side. I'll just put it in my paper box. And then if I'm making a bigger picture at some point, I can use it on that. So it's all right. Nothing's really wasted when you're doing mixed media. You can always use things again. But I think it is important to realise that none of us are perfect, and none of us know what we're doing all the time. Or if any other time. But it's important just to practice and play and have fun with it. It is all about having fun. If you're wondering where I got my alphabet stampers from, I've got them from all different places. So these ones were from the internet. I think they were from eBay or Amazon. eBay, I think. And then the big letters that I use, I got them from Flying Tiger. And another set I was gifted, and then I got the other set from a online craft wholesaler. So you can pick them up from all over, but I highly recommend it because they are such fun to use. So again, just like before, when we was putting the paper down, I'm not going to stick anything. I'm just going to keep moving these around until I get them in a position that I actually like. Because if you've already got sticky stuff on them, you won't be able to keep moving them. So I'm just going to move them around. And don't be afraid to cut the words up like I'm doing. And just wiggle them around to see where they should go. So I'm going to try and line these up. So if you can see, I'm seeing which is the best compilation for them, and I'm not quite sure yet, so I think I'm going to leave them ones at the edge. Yeah, and you can see I've lined them up now, so the end ones all in a line and the middle ones are in a line. I'm going to use some double-sided sticky tape for these. Again, if you are going to do this to sell, you'd want to do the double-sided sticky tape, and when everything's dry, properly dry, you'd want to Mod Podge over the whole thing to make sure that it was stuck down properly, otherwise it can just lift off. It is handy to have nails to pick these double-sided sticky tapes off. And if you find that they keep coming off together, you've not pushed them down enough. So when you first put them on, make sure you really press them down hard onto the table. And always put the double-sided sticky tape onto the things that you're sticking on, not the other way around. So I wouldn't put the double-sided sticky tape onto the flat piece of card. So all the bits are stuck down now. I took a little bit out of that video because I thought it was a little bit boring just watching me do that. And I'm going to again add some bits of black watercolour pencil around the edges just to make it pop again, to make it look like the words are coming off the page. Just like I did before with the watercolour pencils, and I will add some brown and some other colours as well. I'm going to use my Van Gogh watercolour palette. It's metallic paint, it's really lovely. You can tell the ones that I've used the most of. Or you could use a gold pencil if you wanted to do this, but I'm going to use this watercolour. And I'm going to use the copper because I think the copper goes really nice with green. I'm just going to add it onto the image to give it that little bit of sparkle, a little bit of glitz on there, but not too blingy. I'm just going to add a little bit to each part of the words. And I think it just gives that warm feeling. I really love that copper colour. So I've mainly used the coppers and the golds and the silver. The other ones, where you can see it's like blue and pink and green and stuff, they're just like washes that go over the top. You can't actually really see them. I don't really know what the point of them is, to be honest. But I do love this copper, so I'm just going to add it in different places, and I think it really does something to the image. I'm going to add some of these stickers on now. These stickers are really good because even though you can see it's got like a white background on it, they stick down really well and it's almost see-through. I really like them. So I'm just going to add a few of these stickers just to add that little bit of colour. Now you can see me figuring out where I want to put them on the page, and before I was talking about balance and your eye and getting used to the balance of where things are, and this is what I'm actually doing now. I'm looking at where I stuck the other one and doing it in the alternate corner, so it just brings in that bit of balance into your work. Take your time in whatever you're doing and just look where you want to put things. So you'll see me pause because I'm trying to figure out, does it actually look nice there? So allow yourself that time to figure out where things should actually go, where you think they should go, where it feels like they should go. Really happy with this now. Really happy that I've done what I set out to do and I've made something really nice. And I hope that you're really happy with your work when you make it too. Now, so this is a micron pen and it's brilliant because even if you put water over the top of it, it's not going to smudge. So I'm just looking here, I'm going to add some little stars. I always add stars to things, I don't know why, it's just my signature thing that I like to do. Stars and dots, I love it. So these micron pens, I don't even know if that's how you say it properly, but they are really good because a lot of other pens will smudge if you add water to them. I hope you really enjoyed watching that tutorial and I can't wait to see what you make. Don't forget to give me a comment, share what you make, and have fun.